Good evening. Welcome to our parish mission. Welcome to all. And may I just say that before we start, that Father Benz will be here. So if you're over at the edge and you wanted to come in a little closer, there are more seats here. You might be able to hear and participate a little more. So not forcing, but if you would like, you can come over here. Thank you. And, so first, I'd like to welcome all of you. Thank you for taking this evening and these evenings of this week to spend the time here to express with your very selves the importance of our faith and of being with Jesus and walking with him in the world. Our mission, the name of our mission is See and Believe. And Pope Francis and our parish have called us to be missionary disciples. And so when we heard when we settled on the idea here of a parish mission this Lent, immediately to my mind popped the name and image of Father Jack Benz, the chaplain at Boise State University. Welcome to you again, Father Benz. I know that you have seen him and already engaged with him this past weekend in his presiding and preaching at our masses. And the reason that Father Benz popped into my mind was because he is a man of mission. He belongs to the Society of Jesus and has done great missionary works truly for the Society. And he is, as I mentioned, presently the chaplain at Boise State University, a Catholic chaplain, which has become a very vibrant, growing faith community through his leadership and inspiration there, work together with the community. And before that, he was vocation director for the Jesuits. He's had a number of very important works, but rather than go through his CV, let me just say that in coming to know his work and watching him online, there's kind of a common thread that I've discerned, and that is he's looking not simply at what is, but at what is possible. And I think that's really at the heart of mission. What is possible for us? How can we walk closer with Jesus, come to know him better? And what is possible for our church? What can we together build here at All Saints, in our communities, so that we are worshiping Jesus not only in these beautiful four walls, but all through our lives. So it is a great joy to be able to welcome you here. Father Benz, thank you for taking the time and generosity to come from your mission there in Idaho and to be with us. And I won't take any more of your time.
Continue to shine your light through us. This evening, bind away any evil spirit that wants to close our minds, that wants to keep us inward focused, that wants to keep us blind. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
So, he's being summoned by the military. So, I asked most people to get a name tag. I think most of you got a name tag as you arrived this evening. And since I'm new and I want to meet more of you, we're going to do a small exercise together that we'll be able to talk about after it. And I'd like you to find someone new that you don't know necessarily, rather than just turn to your husband, and ask them the story of their name. Everybody has a name, and everybody, there's a story around that name. Like, why is it that name and something else? For example, I live with a Filipino priest whose name is Radmar Howe, and a total made-up name. That's like, I think, a compilation of his three of his grandfathers, or two grandfathers and a friend or something. So it's like Rodolfo and Amadeus and Mario or something. It's like crammed together, and you're like, that's crazy. But everybody has some story like that, so find someone and do that. One of the things also I just wanted to alert us to is that you notice you're a little constrained by the pew, right? You could talk to someone right next to you or right across from you, or behind you or in front of you. Pews are really great for sitting politely and listening in rows. And that's fine. But at the same time, what really helps us in the church is that architecture of the chairs, of the rows like that. But what it also hinders is it's you have to be very intentional about how you build community in spite of those pews, right? So often the structure that helps us in one thing is something that we have to overcome in another way. So these people up here in this front row, even though they're in the same room, are really far removed from the people in the back row. So I just wanted to alert us to that and some of the just built-in challenges of building community within a church. I felt so welcomed here this last weekend. I was at all the masses, preaching at all of them and presiding at some of them. A great experience for me, and so that was terrific. And often retreat talks or mission talks like this can fill your notebook full of brand new insights. You know, this is not one of those missions. Most of the stuff that we'll be considering is stuff that we do all the time or that we experience all the time, but hopefully this is a three-night chance to dig deeper into what we already know and see it in a new way. So that when we go back into our church life, in the minute you walk out here, that it resonates at a deeper level. I hope that's the case. One of the things that I love is how the whole dynamic of a Catholic parish works. Because it's a totally man-made, woman-made, human-made construct that we all just accept as like, oh, well, that's just how it works. But it could work several different ways and has worked a whole bunch of different ways. And parish to parish, it's very different in even one city and then certainly internationally. But I love how people come together in a group to worship God together. So in the next three evenings, we're going to be talking about generally parishes, but probably what will come to your mind is your parish. Your worship community will be coming to your mind. And so you can ask yourself just right now, like, how is All Saints doing at the moment? And as a parish, you know, does it grieve you like, ah, it's not working for me? Or, wow, it's great, or all those things of the parish. Because it turns out that a community is always growing or dying. It's a little like a shark. It has to keep going, you know? And if it's coasting, there's only one direction coasting organizations go, which is you only coast down. Rarely does anyone coast up, you know? How's your life going? I'm coasting. That's just, did it happen? So parishes, certainly, when they're in without intentionality, they usually coast, and coasting is usually going down. Rick Warren, who runs Saddleback down in Orange County, he says that pastors of parishes are either risk takers, caretakers, or undertakers. Right? And so you can ask yourself, how is the parish going? You know, what's happening there? Because it's a dynamic organism. And since it's a dynamic organism, living is kind of the point. And I know we use this word a lot these days, which is community, and most of us have some experience of a community that comes to mind when people say community, right? And for me, I've spent a lot of time in communal settings, and I don't mean I was in a commune or in a kibbutz, you know, I wasn't raised like that, but I was raised out in the country on a ranch, and it's a very communal, it's just unavoidably communal. Because that's the only way you can actually get anything done as a group. And my parents thought ahead and had six boys my size, which is a lot of free labor. And I think that saved them a lot. But it's very, very communal, very communal. And then my background is as a theater worker. So I trained as an actor and a director and then became a theater producer. And all along, a theater is very, very communal. And the most satisfying part about theater, other than the bright lights, is you get to have an idea and then a whole group of people get to make it happen together. And it's such a communal experience. If any of you have done theater, you have that experience of of creating something together. And then it was relatively easy to go into religious life because Jesuits live in communities. You know, we don't live in monasteries. We live in communities specifically as a community. And all these, the Jesuits, theater, branch, my family, all those things are all communities, and they're all weird and intense. All of those. And the thing is that a lot is expected of members of these communities. I mean, a lot. Dead weight just doesn't cut it. Just doesn't last. And you know, if you grew up in a large family, the only person in a large family that doesn't have a job is the baby. That's it. You know, everyone else is part of it. Everyone has a job except the baby. And so this set me up for community in the church. And this is the Catholic experience of community. Weird, intense, very, very communal. It's same and different, because right now it seems in the Catholic Church, I can't speak about the Middle Ages, but it seems right now that a lot of us are spiritual babies. And I don't mean that as a derogatory term. I mean in a real community, everybody has a job except the baby. And we always need a lot of babies around because people, I hope, are just coming to the church brand new. And then they're growing up in the church and developing. And right now, I think sometimes we have an excess of babies, not because they refuse to grow up, because they're often not given an opportunity to, or an expectation to move forward into the church. So this is a special area of interest to me. And maybe I have a grudge against babies, because I'm the second to the youngest, so there's always a baby, always got everything, except me. But I'm interested in how Catholic parishes rest in the context of the wider community. And what are we doing in these communities? You know, because you have the community of the church nested within this larger community. And what makes a good parish, and why are some parishes not thriving and growing, and others are? And this is important in the abstract, but it's vitally important to us personally as Catholics. Because many of us are in these communities of question. And how does it all work? So the parish mission that we begin tonight is a way for us to reflect on the dynamic that exists in Catholic parishes. Parishes like All Saints fill with people like you, looking for God together, and hopefully together being strengthened by the Spirit to be a force of good in the world. That's hopefully broadly the mission that we all share, whatever our articulated parish mission statement is. But this doesn't just happen. I mean, I believe we want to follow God. This is the important part. And we want to be part of that mission, the mission begun by Jesus and then carried on by us. And we stand on this incredible history in the church of saints and martyrs and evangelists. And here we are tonight, many of us, at some point because someone at some point proclaimed the good news to our ancestors. Somewhere, someone was walking along, killing a buffalo, or whatever ancestors were doing, and someone proclaimed the good news to them. And then they found salvation in following Jesus. None of us have always been Catholic as a family. None of us have. And it's helpful for us to recall that and to know that someone proclaimed the good news to somebody in my past, and they took a chance on it. And we're called to proclaim that same good news to somebody else. Maybe for the first time, but also maybe for the next time, or the 400th time, in a way they can actually hear it and move forward into it. So we're part of the Jesus movement that continues to change the world to offer salvation from certain death. And I know sometimes we back away from that truth claim, but that's what we're doing. Is that we're proclaiming that following Christ will save you from certain and final death. And to heal people of blindness and to change them into living water for themselves and their communities. And if this thing is really lofty and like, well, that's fine, I'm sure someone's doing that somewhere. No, that's our mission. That's us. That's the opportunity right here and right now for all of us. Great. So, you might say, that's great, but how are we going to do this? And it's a good question. I'm glad you asked. This is a question we continue to ask. to get partial answers and to evaluate our answers and continue to open ourselves to the Spirit in this work. And we will find ways to be part of this great work that are effective today. And I suspect the answers to creating a vibrant, relevant missionary church will come from a whole variety of sources. The biggest one is pray. And I don't say that lightly, just, oh yeah, pray more. I know I've been told that over and over again, maybe because I need to. But it's true. Praying will do that. And tradition, delving deep into our tradition that we have. And other disciplines in the world, like business, leadership, psychology, and from our own store of experience, we'll begin to understand, how do we actually do this? How do we translate that huge mission that we are given as Christians into really reaching out into the world? So these three sessions we have together, we consider three sets of ideas that I hope will inspire us. Inspire us to accept the challenge to become truly followers of Christ in how we spread the good news in our local communities, and even spreading that good news to the people in the pews next to us who might need it desperately and need it from us. So tonight we're going to discuss community and belonging, and tomorrow we'll move on to the Word and believing, and finish on Wednesday with some reflections on the Eucharist and behaving. Now, some of this seems familiar, the sequence of belonging, believing, behaving. Purposely tried to, you know, make that part of what I was preaching about this weekend. So we'll take that structure and go a little deeper into it. So tonight, community and belonging. It's hard to talk about the church without talking about the collection of people in the church. Those, you know, who are the church. But are we a community or a collection of people? A collection of people is what you would find if you went to the movies. You go into a movie theater, and that's a collection of people. They've collected there to watch a movie. Now, sometimes parishes can feel like that, and you might say, that's not ideal, and you would be right. Also, a collection of people can get on a bus, and they might be going the same place, but they're a collection of people. They're going somewhere kind of on the same bus. Not really together or incidentally. They may all have different reasons to go into San Francisco, but they're all on the same bus. Or there's a collection of people that use the same coffee shop. There's a group that come in at 7 a.m., there's a group coming at 9, another group, you know. But that's a collection of people. So the church is a community of people, not a collection of people. Do we know that? Do we experience that? Because a community has this dynamic of knowing each other and being known. Is that how you think or differentiate your experience of being in a community, a parish, as opposed to the coffee shop that you frequent? Is there a different tangible piece? In part, that's what the name tags are as well. Is rarely do you go into a coffee shop and they want a name tag. You know, there's trying to know and to be known. And that's a very important piece. 2 years ago, my brother was killed in a plane crash. His own plane was flying. And he was killed, and then, you know, the funeral happened, and I did the funeral. And I had this experience of doing the funeral on a Friday. And it was this huge funeral because he was 51, you know, I had a family of five, and all of that. You know, it's just about as much fun as it sounds. And I did that funeral, and then because of my schedule, I had to leave and I was in Boise, and then I had to leave and go to Spokane and do a wedding at 2:00 on Saturday. And then I had to be back in Boise to do Mass at 11 on Sunday, right? And doing the wedding, I felt I could not tell them what had just happened. Because I didn't want to, that's no fun. I mean, you just can't. That's what you need to do. And that experience of not was really hard because you can't let people know what's going on. And you have to just soldier on. Okay, I'm going to be excited about your wedding. Here we go. And my friends Paige and Lewis, it was their wedding, and it went well, and I was just dazed and confused. And that is the experience sometimes some of us have in church, when it's a collection and not a community. You know, because we don't, somehow, we haven't been able to build the structures where we are known and know each other. Now, there are several ways that can happen. We'll talk a little bit about them. One of the things that happens in some of the big evangelical megachurches is they will say rows don't know, but circles do. So they have these huge megachurches, and then they also have small groups because they purposely say, we can't make that work in just these rows, because rows don't know, but circles do, you know? That's one way of doing it, but there's several different ways that that can happen. But what's possible is true community, right? Real, true community is possible. And your experience of church will depend on what you think church is supposed to be. Isn't that true in life, though, really? It's like, it kind of depends on what your expectations are of any event, because if it falls short, your expectations might have been wrong, or the event might have been terrible. It just kind of, you know, we're always kind of balancing those sorts of things. But often, church really falls into two categories for us. What kind of expectations are you showing up with? Are you hoping to get something, or are you hoping to give something? It's a real different dynamic. If you show up at church and think, I'm here to receive, or I'm ready to give. I work with young adults, and I was talking to a kid who had gone to Catholic grade school, Catholic high school, and he wasn't going to, and then went to Catholic college, and went to Boston College. And then I was talking to him afterwards, and I said, so where do you go to church? He said, I don't go to church. And I was like, well, why don't you go to church? He said, because there's really nothing there for me. And we all hear that. Sometimes we say it, right? I don't get anything out of it. Well, that's a person that's very much in the, I'm here for something. If I don't get it, then I'll go somewhere else. And that puts the pressure on the organization to serve you, your needs, your desires, you. And it doesn't challenge us to grow at all, right? Conversely, to give, if you show up to give, like, oh man, this is a place I really want to give. I'm going to go to church because I want to give, or I'm going to go to church because I had this experience of Jesus that changed my life, and this is a place for me to blah, you know, give back, or give praise, or to give worship. You know, this is a place for that. And this will be, it pulls this out of you, this generosity, your talents, and your desires. And this is the difference between being a consumer and a contributor when it comes to church. And it's hard for us. It's hard for us because we're used to stores. We're used to going someplace and buying. You know, I need a hammer. Well, I'll go to the hammer store. If I don't need a hammer, I won't go to the hammer store. A lot of people, I think, don't go to church because they're like, I don't need whatever they're selling. Why would I go? You know? So what's your experience of showing up at church? Do you think you're more a contributor or consumer? Or maybe sometimes it's a little of both? But I think we're actually a community of contributors at the core. And not just of cash, but of time, attention, always seeking ways to pour ourselves out on behalf of those in need and a world with need. And I think that's a human desire, is to pour ourselves out. You know, I have all these brothers. I have one sister. She's the eldest, and then she has six little brothers. God help her. And they all get married, they have kids, all the rest. And they are all pouring themselves out. I mean, when they're done with their life, it's going to be just the wrapper that's left, right? Because they have all these kids on them. And I want the same thing for my life. You know, how do you find a way to pour yourself out, to give yourself completely, and a place to do that? And I think we are a world, we are a community, but we are a particular kind of community. We're not just a service organization, we're a particular kind of community in the church. We are the body of Christ, right? That's the kind of community we are. That takes it to a whole different level. Acts 4:32. The community of the believers was of one mind and one heart. That would say that it's a body. The community was of believers was of one heart and of one mind. That's where we're headed towards. Or in Romans 12:5. Paul writes, so we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually parts of one another. Wow, that is reaching high, right? That's us. That's us on a Sunday morning at All Saints. That we could be that. And it's not a magical way of thinking on the part of Paul or the writer of Acts. It's how they experience themselves. is that, wow, you know, we're coming together around this Jesus who used to be here and isn't here right now, and what's going on? And that's how they experienced it. It is though we are as one body. Ever had a friend that was that close that you felt like you were one person? Or how great if your spouse is like that, you have that relationship? How great, you're that tight. And if our Catholic community is the body of Christ, what happens when the body is dismembered? Two things happen. The piece that is separated dies, and the rest of the body is impaired. And how does that image, this understanding, call us to service, to care for other people, love my neighbor as myself? Well, your neighbor is yourself. It's not a big stretch, because that's who we are as a Catholic community, right? And how does that inspire us to commit once we think we are a community and that community is the body of Christ? It inspires us to show up, to remain connected. And the church of the body is complete. It has everything it needs. They just might not all be in the same room together yet. So that's the work in the church of ecumenism or interfaith work or the dead. Because we think that the communion of saints is part of this, right? Is that that's the remembering of the body of Christ. And as you might know, this helped me, is that the Catholic parish system is geographical, right? So it ends here, goes there. And the Catholics think that everyone in that geographical region is part of the parish. Some of them are Catholic. Isn't that great? That's taking seriously that the body of Christ is everybody. And so how are we inspired towards them? And that we're connected intimately to them outside of these walls. And whether they're Catholic or not, they belong to us. Okay, so we're the body of Christ. But we're not a movie audience, we're not passengers on a bus, and we're not members of a club. We're part of a community, and a very specific kind of community, the body of Christ. And no, we're the body, not the head. And this one body of Christ has a specific mission, existing for a purpose, the mission of Christ. Now, sometimes the church can feel like a club, serving its members. That's what a club does. Like if you're a member of the club, you get, you know, certain deals, you get, you know, kind of a price reduction on this, or you're going to get this thing. If you're a member of the Catholic club, you get the Eucharist, you get a wedding, and you get a priest to help with your stuff, and you get a front row seat in heaven when you die. My brothers are very keen on this. They're like, oh, you're a priest, great. So, front row. I don't know exactly how that works. I don't know who told them that was going to happen. But it's not a club. We're part of an organization that exists only for the benefit of those who are not yet in it. Isn't that weird? The Catholic Church is an organization that exists only for the benefit of those who are not yet in it. Right? Evangelization. Too often, we think about the Catholic Church as just leave a light on and people will show up. Or we're here to care for the Catholics. When I first started at Boise State University, there's 22,000 students on the campus. And then there's another 4,000 faculty staff, so 26,000 people in that campus. And my Jesuit brothers would ask, oh, you're going to Boise State? That's fantastic. How many Catholics are there? And I would say, no, they'd say, how many students? I'd say, 22,000. And they'd say, how many Catholics? And I'd say, well, they don't keep track because it's a state school, but probably 2,000. And they said, oh, 2,000 Catholics, great. How many show up at church on the weekend? I said, well, we have two masses, and it only seats 200, so probably 400 a weekend. And they said, so we're sending a priest to work someplace for 400 Catholics. And then I would get depressed. I would think, yeah, that's a waste of time. Rather than, now I answer the question like this. A Jesuit brother would ask, so how many students at Boise State? I'll say 22,000. They're like, great, how many Catholics? And I said, we're not there for the Catholics. We're there for 22,000 and the 4,000 faculty and staff. So that's one priest for 26,000 people. Now that seems more normal, unfortunately, you know, because that's the work. That's our work. And if you'll notice how many people are in Hayward, well, good luck. There's a lot of people, right? So that's the evangelization that we're going for. This is who we are, but how do we activate this reality? Where's the on button for this evangelization? If we want All Saints to be a parish that's on fire with the mission to bring all to Christ, where do we start? And I think the first place we can all look is how welcoming is your current church community? And, you know, as I said, when I was here this weekend, I felt very welcome. But I have a skewed opinion because I'm wearing a collar and I'm surrounded by Filipino Catholics. So like, hi, Father. Yes, Father. Hold on. And I was like, oh, God, you guys. You know, so I can't speak for everybody else, but I was treated great. But it's the everybody else that's more to the point, right? More to the point. And so greeters, smiling people, names, you know, probably name tags Sunday occasionally. Fantastic, so important. But one of the hard things about hospitality or welcoming that I've discovered at where I work right now is it's such an act of imagination to think about the outsider, think about a person who's here for the first time. And studies have shown that every Catholic parish, certainly in the U.S., every Sunday, there are people that are checking it out. People that are like, you know, we've had our third kid, and we raised Catholic, and let's go. We hated it then, but let's go see what it's like. And if we were actually able to welcome and encourage and, you know, find a place for them, there would be no getting into our churches. Because every weekend, brand new people show up. And our imaginative act is to try to figure out, what do they need? How are they going to find a way in? When I first started work at the Catholic Student Center, we had a hard time figuring this out. So announcements would go like this. If you're interested in being an EM, please see Rose in the Nook. No one knew what an EM was, a Eucharistic minister. No one knew who Rose was. And no one knew where the hell the Nook was, okay? And we're like, man, we're just getting nowhere with getting Eucharistic ministers to show up. You get it, right? Like, it's like, whoop! And that happens all the time in our churches, right? And because we talk in this code language that only if you're on the inside would you know what the hell they're talking about. That is the only way you would know that. And these kind of assumptions, when you say, I heard it last night, actually. I heard the young adult come stand up, give a conversation, say, hi, my young adults, and we're having nachos in the senior center. And sat down. Like, which is fine if you know where the senior center is. You know what I mean? And this happens to me all the time. Because we're on the inside. We know this stuff. But the imaginative act of hospitality is thinking about the person that doesn't know the stuff, who's not already on the inside, right? Or even, we've now been able to do this all the time, is that, hi, welcome to St. Paul's, it's great to have you here. My name is Father Vance, blah, blah, blah. And if you're here for the first time, it's great. And the bathrooms are just through that door to the right. Because people, why would they know where they are? Why would they know where they are, right? So that's an imaginative act of that. And then for those people that find this welcome, then they can move towards belonging. And we want more than just a warm welcome. We want something to do, right? We want some expectations placed on us rather than just show up, give me the Eucharist, and leave me alone. I don't think that's Catholics at their best. I think that's Catholics who are just trying to just get through it. just get it over with. Father, can you go faster just to get this over with? What are you having, a tooth pulled? You know, like, we'll try to, and that's evidence of someone who hasn't been able to be welcomed into belonging, and then to move to believe and to, you know, change their behavior, which is on us, not on them, right? So I think the reason we remain consumers and don't embrace our call to be contributors is often we are never asked to actually be part of things, or not asked in ways we can respond to. There are two values that are going here, which is welcome and expectations. And Father Mallon, if you haven't read him, he wrote a book called Divine Renovation, and he's just spectacular. And I learned so much from him, Divine Renovation. And one of the things he talks about is the values of welcome and expectations for Catholics when they show up at a church. Is that there's a grid here, because sometimes the welcome is really high. You're so welcome, and everyone's singing, oh, welcome, oh. And then nothing is expected of you. at all. It's just all welcome and no expectation. There's no expectation that you could be involved in this or come and be part of that or do this with these other people or we're all going to go downtown and do this, those kind of expectations. Or it's low welcome and high expectations. Some communities are like that too. You're not welcomed, but it's slave labor the minute you show up. And you're forced to be, what? I wasn't even welcome. No one even knows my name. And suddenly, I'm what? Sometimes this can happen with the money part. I wasn't welcomed here, but I was asked to get out my checkbook. Nobody likes that. And not just because we're greedy and selfish, because we weren't welcomed. We have no sense of way to belong. Or low welcome and low expectations. This is often churches. I wasn't welcomed and then nothing was expected of me. So why aren't I just home watching the game? You know, no low welcome, low expectation. And what we're trying to do is, what the goal is, high welcome and high expectations, right? Because over and over again, people leave the Catholic Church and go to, you know, other churches, like non-denominational churches, because of a couple things. The welcome and the preaching. I know this is no surprise, we're all Catholics. Is that, were they welcomed? And was the preaching not only good, like interesting, but put demands on them to change their life and to be part of something bigger than they are and to go to Africa and work with whatever, and, you know, do these sorts of things. That we can do better on that. And why would we bother expecting a lot of people? Are we just like, oh man, we're not going to lay some heavy trip on you? No. People want to give. We all want to give ourselves away. And this is especially true of young people. And if you think young people just want to like use organizations and use the church or just want to be left alone, that's not my experience at all. Every day I'm surrounded by young people who want to be involved, who want to do stuff. And we are forgetting, we think they don't want to be involved, we're forgetting everything we know about young people who want to be involved in doing something meaningful and worthwhile, finding ways to do that. And this is the core teaching of the call of Christ, right? The very first one, when he says to those first disciples, he says, come, and I will make you fishers of men. Like, you barely have a chance to catch your breath before you're sent out to do something. You're like, come, and I will make you fishers of men. And those young guys are like, I'm in. Give me something to do. Give me a way to be part of this thing. Ways to contribute and ways to receive, right? So high welcome, high expectations. And there's a respectful way of responding to people, right? Because here's a quote from Father Malin's work. He says, we believe that God will work in you and work through you. We expect it and you should too. How about if that was messaged in our parish a lot? That this, again, we believe that God will work in you and work through you. We expect it, and you should too. You should expect that God is going to use you. So put on your boots, come to Mass, be ready to, you know, go on mission. So this is who we are. How do we claim it? What can you do to change this welcome expectation thing in your parish? Can you welcome and expect anything from other people? Just as, you know, just a regular Catholic. And I think that expectation gets met only in relationship. Otherwise, like, if you were to ask me for $10, I'd be like, well, I don't know. What was your name again? You know? But if I knew you, I'm like, sure. Or would you drive me to the airport tomorrow morning? She's like, yeah, sure. I'll drive you now if we can chat. But she doesn't know me, so why would she? You know, know and trust right there. Know and trust. So, here's some things that I think can help shift groups, help shift us at Bronco Catholic. The name thing, it just can't be more important. And I am name tag averse. I would rather not fill out a name tag, right? But the more names I get to know, and now I know probably 95% of the people that come to the chapel. And we don't have chairs enough for them, which is fantastic, and we keep it. What we ask for is people to give us money for more chairs. What a great thing to have to do in a church. which is great. But, you know, a lot of my work is getting to know everyone's name. And then we have a whole set of volunteers that do a lot of hosting with us and for us, students that get to be involved in that. And secondly, Pew Hospitality. This is a great experience. I saw this happen in our chapel just 2 weeks ago. Is that, you know those people that are pew and hogs? Myself, you've been shoved in, kind of bitter about it. Because like there's going to be a fire, or you might not like it. Yeah, just need it by the door would be best. You know, that's probably how you were at school too, right? I'll be sitting way in the back near the door. Those pew and situations, that's pew hospitality. So I saw this at the chapel. There were two guys that are normally there, and they were sitting at the end of the pew because we're all down. And these two new students showed up, and they had to crawl over those two students. Nothing says a welcome like having to crawl over two people you don't know. Right? It's a small thing, but take care of them. Meet them there. Help them out. And most of us aren't friendly because we don't act friendly because it's not because we're bad people. It's we don't want to bother people usually. You know, we don't want to get their space. We want to leave them alone and that sort of thing. But that's not why they're here at church. That's not why they bothered to come here. You know, even the grouchiest, most, you know, antisocial, you know who you are. They want, or you're married to them. You know, they do want to belong. They really do. Finally, outside of Mass, I said the pews is a hard place to actually get community going. So any kind of hospitality before, after Mass, showing up for it, talking to the people. And I don't know if you have after Mass hospitality, after Mass is here, or maybe it's occasional or whatever. But trying to figure out how is a brand new person invited into that. Because it's often very intimidating to go into a new space where you don't know anybody and just bam, you're in there. Are you committed? And then suddenly you're like having to make your way through a cup of coffee with strangers, you know, trying to do that. And then being part of programming in small groups and all those social gatherings, like continue to show up and continue to talk. Now, of course, I'm preaching to the choir because you're here at the parish mission, right? But look at the group that's here. Jesus only had 12. There's a lot more of y'all here. We should be able to take on the world, right? But with this kind of thing, these kind of pieces. So perhaps you notice that this entire hour has been kind of about evangelization, and I've not suggested a single way we might talk to someone about Jesus. Anyone notice that? Yeah, it's a lot of structure stuff. Because this is all pre-evangelization. This is on purpose. Because our evangelization as a church is done like Jesus did evangelization. Our model is come and see. Come and see. You don't start the conversation with someone who's not a believer with, okay, this is how the Trinity works. No. Or, this is how the Eucharist works every time. Let's just break down the real presence for a moment. No. You say, come and see. Jesus is a model on that. And so people have to come to a sense of belonging before they can come to belief, before they can believe deeply enough in the person of Jesus and the teaching of Jesus and the example of his followers, that's us, that the testimony of Catholics before they begin to change how they behave and change how they live their lives. Think about it this way. In most parish settings, we receive communion in the same way. So think about this tonight and then the next two, which is three parts of receiving communion. And think about communion and community, ring a bell, is that three parts. We process together with the whole church. We process together. These little lines, you know, we don't rush it like suddenly we're at a train station. We come up together, right? And then we say amen together to the body of Christ. The person will hold up the body of Christ, we say amen, we receive it. That's the second piece. That's tomorrow when we talk about the word. And then receiving the body of Christ into your body. Receiving the body of Christ into your body. That's going to be Eucharist and behavior. And if we think that receiving of the body of Christ is going to save people, then we want that to happen. We want that for everybody. Not just for us, but for everybody. And we might have been going to communion for so long that we just get in line. I know that I do. I go to communion a lot. And rather than experience the moment, that procession forward as the body of Christ moving together towards the Eucharist, That's what we're doing at that point. When we stand up, move down your aisle, come to the pew into the aisle, is that it's the body of Christ walking together. It's kind of a big deal that we know what's going on at that moment. And not just because we're avoiding trying to bump into people or trying to figure out receiving on a hand or tongue or we don't all just rush to the front. But at that moment, it's not just getting it over with, but being active members of the body of Christ. It isn't that what we said we wanted? That we wanted to be remembered as members of the body of Christ? Think about the politics of just this last year. The election and all that. Who hasn't wanted to just move forward together? That's what we get to do here. Here we are, a group, a variety of politics, no doubt. And we get to do something together. We get to do it here. Every Sunday we get the chance to move together forward. It's a wide range of people. The diverse group that we know is the church, towards receiving the body and blood of Christ together. And many of us are thinking about anything else when we get in the line. I'm trying to bring this to mind also. I was trying all during the weekend, like I'm down here doing a job, and trying to bring that to mind, trying to be really present to real presence, which is the challenge for us. The challenge for us. And the community is needed a real experience of belonging that will be the first step to the saving power of Christ in the universe. That's where we're headed. Which I hope we want for as many people as Jesus wants it for. That's a piece that eludes me often. The experience of belonging to a people headed together towards something. And as someone who begins this journey, they might not even know where we're headed yet. And exactly, they're willing to come and see. These are our friends, our family, that we could say, you could belong here. You could belong here. And I think God can work with that, just that simple sense of come and see. Because he did. He worked with people who were willing to just come and see. And God can work with us and our simple desire to do that. The fact is, the reason you're here this evening is because the Spirit is pulling you forward. God doesn't meet us halfway. No, that's Pelagianism, just to let you know. He doesn't meet us halfway. He meets us all the way, all the time. And our desire to be part of God is God working in us already. How do we just cooperate with that a little bit? Hopefully this is firing you up just enough to get you to check out this evening. That's what happened with you, right? And this means you have something that we all need. You are that member of the body of Christ that we all need right here. Even if you feel you have nothing to give, your part of the body of Christ is the one that is needed now. And evidence of that is that you are here. And what is it you have to offer the community, and how can you be part of bringing all to Christ? That's food for prayer. What is it that you have? And also then, who do you know that needs to belong at this moment in your life? They might not yet believe in Jesus or behave very well at all, but I bet they long to belong. And we can be that way for them. We can welcome them, and we can bring them towards Jesus. Hopefully this will cue us up for the next step, which is tomorrow night, when we talk about the word and that notion of actually saying amen as the body of Christ to the Eucharist, when we talk about word of God and belief. I'm going to end it there. If you have questions, we have a little bit of time for that. I know it's right up at 8. I used to be an actor and work in the union, and then I worked as a director. And we were always charged if we went over time. So I've gotten a little bit jumpy, you know. But if you have any questions on this or things that popped up for you, we can wrap it up with a prayer. Yes.
What is your solution for AIPAC in the church? I mean, that's a hard thing to do, but I have often wanted it because I remember that person, but for the life of me, I cannot remember their name, and they're part
probably thinking the same thing. And if we had name tags, that would be eliminated.
Yeah, I agree with you. And it's worth wondering, like, if you are really anti-name tag, like I kind of am, it's worth asking, why am I so against it? You know, like, do I just think it's a bother, or do I not really care about people's names? And so what a good thing can be to do is, as a parish, try to figure out one Sunday every 6 months is Name Tag Sunday, and we're handing them out, and then we're going to actually, at the top of Mass, actually meet some people next year. I think it's just an ongoing challenge to do that. Because right now, there are some of you that, through this lecture site, now know each other's actual name. Like, I was going to call her Sandy, but it's actually Becky. it's like thankfully for that name tag, right? And so I think it's an ongoing piece, and it shows commitment on the part of the parish to make this happen. Yeah. Sure. Good. Thank you all. Let's close with a prayer, shall we? In Father, Son, Holy Spirit, Amen. Gracious God, you send us forth. You send us forth from this first evening of this 3-evening mission. Continue to help us to respond to you in our lives and in our community. Continue to give us that insight that we need to see ourselves in that community and what's needed. Help us to know that our gifts are needed and so important to continue to complete the body of Christ. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you all.